Amelia was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at the age of 10. She looked pretty good, despite a difficult, some may say devastating, diagnosis. Her parents, who were with her, looked a lot worse. Type 1 diabetes occurs because the immune system attacks the insulin-producing cells of the pancreas. People with diabetes struggle each day to take care of it. It's really hard, especially for the children. High blood sugars can lead to devastating complications like blindness and amputation. I make it a point to meet all the newly diagnosed patients and their families when they come to the Naomi Berrie Diabetes Center that I co-direct. When I met Amelia and her family, her mother told me an astonishing thing. She said that her grandfather, Amelia's great-grandfather, was the first person to receive insulin at my hospital. I was stunned. I have in my office the multi-volume chart of the first person to get insulin for diabetes at New York Presbyterian Hospital. I use his pictures to teach the Columbia medical students about diabetes. Are you related to Edwin Mannheimer? My name is Karen Mannheimer, she said. Edwin Mannheimer was admitted to the hospital for a recent diagnosis of type 1 diabetes in 1922. Back then, type 1 diabetes was a fatal disease. He was 11 years old, he weighed 30 pounds, he couldn't lift his head up from the pillow, and it became too sad for his family to take care of him at home. They brought him to the hospital. It's really sad for me to show these pictures because we take care of a lot of patients, a lot of children with type 1 diabetes, and before 1922, they all would have died. The situation for type 1 diabetes was unchanged before 1922 for thousands of years. The first description of diabetes is shown on the Ebers Papyrus from thousands of years ago. Diabetes has been described in antiquity as the melting of the flesh on the limbs into urine. Life was said to be short and unpleasant. It could have been a description of Edwin. All of that changed in 1922 when an orthopedic surgeon and a medical student made a revolutionary discovery. They extracted the hormone insulin from beagle dogs and found that it lowered sugar in the blood and apparently cured diabetes. Edwin's doctors in New York City wrote to the scientists in Toronto after hearing of this startling research and asked if they would consider sending this newly discovered hormone to try in their dying little patient at the New York Presbyterian Hospital. The insulin came in the mail, as it was described, covered in roots and twigs. And the chart goes on to say the doctors injected it into the little boy and he walked. Edwin, weighing 30 pounds at admission, weighed 60 pounds at discharge. The nurse's notes are the most extraordinary part of this amazing chart. The nurses, a few weeks after the treatment with insulin was started, began describing Edwin as poorly behaved. He ran in the halls. He stole food from the nurse's station. He was generally annoying. In short, he was a normal 11-year-old boy. He was discharged from the hospital, taking insulin among the first people in the world. He grew up. He started a family. He worked in a family chemical company that his family still runs today. By all accounts, he was a lovely man, a volunteer for the Boy Scouts. He developed devastating complications of diabetes. His two sons do not remember him when he wasn't blind. And he died of these complications at the age of 50. insulin treatment back then was barbaric. The outlook for people diagnosed today is much brighter, for a healthy, normal life expectancy free of terrible complications. Thanks to scientists collaborating together on a study called the NIH TrialNet study, we have found ways to identify type 1 diabetes in relatives of our patients even before it occurs. And we are working for the future to prevent diabetes so that no additional family members will develop it. Amelia, 5 years after her diagnosis of diabetes, is doing great. Even her parents are doing great. Jakey developed type 1 diabetes at 11 months old. Among his first words were mama, dada, and pump. That's his insulin pump. Really shouldn't happen. He takes his blood sugar by finger stick 8-15 times a day. He inserts his pump. Patients use a glucose sensor that they have to insert every week or so under their skin. It's hard. The strides in the clinical care have been spectacular. It is not enough. Jakey and his family and all of my patients worry a little bit about their diabetes every day, sometimes more. Too low a blood sugar can cause coma. Too high blood sugars over a long period of time can lead to complications. We need more. The advances have been great, but they're arguably incremental steps over the discovery of insulin made in 1922. We perhaps need a revolution, a new way of looking at a world without diabetes. I recently went to see the Cubist exhibit at the Met, and I discovered it was about science. A patient observed to me that Picasso and Braque are the scientists of the art world. They work together to discover new ways to look at the world. The results were unimaginable before they came along. You can't see it until you see it. Their work led to a revolution that changed the world forever, much the way the discoveries of Banting and Best changed the world forever for my patients. I believe we are poised on the brink of a revolution in the science of diabetes. And it was with this thought in mind that we started the Naomi Berrie Diabetes Center. We want to be ready. We put the research labs right next to the doctor's offices where the patients are cared for, so that it seemed to us the fastest way to the cure is to have everybody talking to each other. The doctors taking care of the patients, the scientists trying to cure it, and to allow the patients access to the scientists as the best way to provide hope and optimism for the future. What I didn't imagine, and what turned out to be even more powerful, were the insights the patients would provide to the scientists. We give lab tours to our patients and families, including this one, to our diabetes camp for children. Our little campers go on outings to New York City landmarks and museums like the Met. These underserved kids, often it's the only time they leave their neighborhood except to go to the doctor. This year, 29 of 30 kids said the lab tour was the best part of diabetes camp. One kid said bowling was better. Dr. Rudy Leibel, my co-director and basic scientist, showed the children laboratory mice with diabetes. The child in the red hat was concerned that their blood sugar was very high, and he said, if you let the blood sugar stay high for a long time, what you'll have there are three blind mice. Dr. Leibel asked the kids, would they consider participating in experimental treatment trials for diabetes? And one little girl said, "Not me. I am perfectly healthy. I'm fine with my insulin. I think those trials could be pretty risky." Important information for the scientists to hear. But one little boy said quietly, "I'll do it. Diabetes hurts." That was it for me. It took all my self-control not to say, "Okay, tour over. We have children worried about going blind. We have children who are suffering. Go back to work." We also give tours to grown-ups, including recently to the artists John Curran and Rachel Feinstein, whose child was diagnosed recently with type 1 diabetes. They were shocked to find the labs were a mess and reminded them of their studios. Artists come to basic science laboratories and see art. This observation is extremely comforting to many of my patients who come on the lab tour and wonder out loud, "Can't I make the scientists stop goofing around? Can't I force them to be more narrowly focused?" And pointing out that science is often messy, that the results come from unexpected directions, go in unexpected places. You can't see it until you see it. That's where the discoveries are made. And I have already seen examples of this in my career. When preliminary experiments were proposed to me in a new field, stem cell research, a few years ago, my response was, "That's insane. That's never going to work." But I was wrong. We can now take skin biopsies in my patients, turn the cells into stem cells, and turn those cells into any cell of the body. When the scientists make heart cells, they beat in the dish. It's unbelievable. When we make pancreatic cells, the cells secrete insulin. And in the future, we'll be able, I think, to have the time when trials are done of transplantation of pancreatic cells that were generated from my patient's skin cells. Another advance that I would have said was impossible comes from the laboratory of Dr. Mimo Achille at Columbia. I've taught the Columbia medical students for decades that only the pancreas can make insulin. Also incorrect. Dr. Achille has shown that the intestine can be induced to make insulin. In the future, instead of insulin shots, my patients might take a pill that causes their gut to make insulin. A cure for diabetes might arise from this very basic research. I tell my patients diagnosed today that I take care of people who are perfectly healthy. They've had diabetes 40 years, 50 years, and not only that, there is no way that my patients today will have it this long because the science is moving fast. Meryl was diagnosed before her second birthday, and she's now 12. She's had diabetes a decade. Enough. My patients and I are ready for cubism to emerge in the science of diabetes. Meryl drew this picture when she was really little, and when a cure is discovered for my patients with diabetes, it'll be a really great day, and we will turn our diabetes center into a bowling alley. Thank you.